Okay, it's happening. Everybody stay calm.
What's the procedure, everyone? What's the procedure?
Stay calm!
Wait.
Everybody calm down!
It's getting real, everyone. Toby is off to cover his tracks, and that means that Holly is back. Hey, I'm Chris, and welcome to The Office Field Guide. I'm reviewing every episode of The Office ever, and today, we're looking at Classy Christmas.
I was after corporate constantly. I emailed Joe. I wrote letters. And know who I end up owing this to is the Scranton Strangler.
Some have called this the beginning of the end of Michael Scott's arc on the series. As such, there is a little dread and whatnot hanging over this episode. We're gonna get into all of that, the snowball fight, Daryl's daughter, and Pam's evil plan to ascend the top of the party planning committee. And in the ratings, we're gonna talk about writing by committee. So, let's go.
I understand nothing.
Something has always felt a little discombobulated about this episode, and I think I've had a revelation as to why that is, but we're gonna get into that later too. Since this is an hour long, I think the best way to work through this is a recap, and then we'll just talk about it along the way. We start off on a beautiful winter morning in Scranton, free and devoid of all drama.
Pam got those sugar-free cookies I like. I'm doing fine.
All right. Good!
A holiday party in the office without drama is definitely an interesting setup, but it doesn't last long. It's established that Pam is now the figurehead of what remains of the party planning committee. Now, if you recall, this coalition became defunct way back in season 5, which is why the Jim Dwight planning stuff for Kelly's party exists in the first place.
It is your birthday, period.
It's a statement of fact.
From what I can remember, I don't think we've had many parties over the last couple years. With Pam's ascension, though, to the office manager, it's now part of her responsibilities. And call Pam a failure all you want, but this might be the most praise she gets in the entire series.
What's the problem?
Nothing. Should be fun.
So good for Pam. But Jim, on the other hand, well, he ends up stepping in it with one simple observation.
It's not even real snow. Look, it's dusting. It's pitiful.
If I was the kind of person who would get triggered by something, this would definitely trigger me. For real, when I was a kid, during the winter, if there was a chance that it was gonna snow outside that day, I would just stare out the window so that I could be the first person to say, "Hey, look, it's snowing outside." And then everyone would just gasp and we would all appreciate the winter of wonder together. Never freaking happened though. I was always late to the game.
The world shines on Moe's.
Jim, for reasons that can only be explained later, decides that his best course of action is to prove that it is, in fact, a substantial snowfall.
Oh!
And yeah, Dwight's reaction was bad, but Jim 100% upped the ante here, and he's going to live to regret that in the coming weeks.
Then I challenge you to a snowball fight on the first real snow of winter.
By the way, this, as always, is filmed in LA, and from what I can read in interviews, it was quite hot during the filming of this one, so keep that in mind during all the outdoor scenes we see. Acting! Later in the day, during the pre-party psych-up meeting, I guess is what it is, the main plot line is kicked into gear when Toby mimes out that he's been selected as a juror for the Scranton Strangler case. If you're watching this video, you are probably aware that Toby being the Scranton Strangler is one of the most popular fan theories from The Office. In his spare time, he's out there strangling people to death. It is probably the theory that most people know about. And this moment in this episode in which Toby becomes a juror for the case always ends up being included as one of the evidence for him being the strangler. So can we just take a moment and think about how weird it would be that Toby would, you know, have somehow positioned himself to get a spot as a juror? That's not how juries work, but also, like, why would he do that? So that he can be one of 7 votes to put away a guy who SWAT was so certain that they already surrounded his house, and then he led police on a high-ish speed chase through Scranton. Fan theory's got a fan theory, though. But along with the revelation that Michael will be free from this darkness in the office,
it was Toby, and the sentence, death,
is the shocking news that corporate is sending Holly Flax in his stead.
Holly Flax, she comes from the Nashville branch.
What?
Sending Holly away was a knee-jerk reaction by David Wallace way back in season 5, and probably was due to all the complications that came from Michael's previous workplace romance. Michael spiraled for quite a while after Holly left, and stepping up to the plate, Michael made this plea to Joe in the season 6 finale.
Hey, you can transfer Holly back from Nashua.
Let me see what I can do.
Driven by a deep desire to make things as good as possible for Holly's re-entry to the Scranton branch, Michael cancels Christmas.
Christmas is canceled.
Cancel, we're canceling it.
No, we have to cancel the party.
We're gonna get fresh for Holly.
These cookies are fine.
Well, at least he pushes it out a couple weeks. Fast forward, and it's the day of the big party. It's snowing outside, and it's also Daryl's day to have his daughter for the holiday. The perfect storm. Michael tasks Pam to class up the joint in order to impress Holly. Assuming that Holly will arrive single and ready to mingle, Michael has not considered the possibility that she might actually stay with AJ, as this is just a temporary assignment to Scranton. At any rate, their reunion is both everything and nothing wrapped into one awkward and incredible package.
Well. It isn't Michael Scott, you old bastard.
Speaking of incredible package, there's a deep subplot in Classy Christmas around Jam's gift giving.
It stars Jimmy Halpert, a mild-mannered paper salesman who, while riding his bike through the forest, is bitten by a radioactive bear.
This is a little more than a normal prop, though. It was created by Tone Rodriguez, who I got to talk to last year in Scranton, which was really kind of cool. The office contacted him about creating a little comic book for the series with some style guides and different things like that. He said he made the book, sent it off, and that was the last he heard about it for years. He wasn't a fan of the show. And then all of a sudden he started seeing his comic book appearing online and he connected it was his. It's kind of a cool story. I really enjoyed meeting Tone. I bought this cool signed Funko Pop, and you can see the comic book in there too.
I love him.
Me too.
But we're going to get into that more later. Meanwhile, Daryl's disheartened because his daughter wants to spend holidays with her mom doing fun stuff, and Daryl is going to get all the boring stuff.
I thought I was enough family for my daughter.
So in an effort to class up the party, Pam and Andy bring a disheartened Daryl along to pick out a real tree. They encourage him not to give up and that they'll make the party fun for Jada. Back at the office, Michael makes a subtle attempt to reconnect with Holly and learns that her and AJ are still together, and then the drama ball drops.
We live together.
Meanwhile, since the snow is in full force, the snowball fight is on. Falling for one of the oldest tricks in the book, Jim is ambushed. So throughout this episode, the fight and the drama continue to escalate, as does Pam and Daryl's anxiety. Michael dumps a beloved Pixar IP in the trash. Dwight pretends to be Pam. Which means that his stance on identity theft have changed.
Yes, I have a wig for every single person in the office. You never know when you're going to need to bear a passing resemblance to someone.
Identity theft is not a joke, Jim. Millions of families suffer every year.
Pam can't find anyone who thinks her comic book is cool.
Are you good at homemade?
Look at this.
Yeah.
And Jada thinks this one-based party is kind of lame.
He doesn't look like Santa Claus.
Jim does try to fight back, causing him to throw a snowball so hard it breaks a window. A window, remember, that Michael couldn't even break. Leading to a confrontation, which creates the crossover drama. One thing I did notice is that Jim keeps his jacket on this entire episode, which maybe for most of the office staff wouldn't be weird.
I feel the need for tweed.
But Jim's jacket is almost always off, except for that brief time he was manager. I think he did this for armor, but I'm not exactly sure.
Stop!
Gryffindor!
The rest of the party plays out with the cringe.
Someday I think we will laugh about this when we tell our kids.
Yikes.
More snowballs, more drama, and the episode does contain the traditional third act musical montage. Michael once again gets insider information from Pam. Daryl teaches Jada the best part of Christmas joy is giving. Jim loves the comic book. And then he undergoes a few minutes of psychological torture.
What? Go, go!
Oh my God! Honey?
Lots of clips there, I know, but let's pull this all together in the deeper meaning.
What does a being mean?
Someone please explain it to Kat.
Something has always intrigued me about this line.
The greatest snowball isn't a snowball at all. It's fear. Merry Christmas.
There's something so classy and smooth about it. And it might just be that the universe is upside down here. That in Benihana Christmas, we close with Dwight, sad and phoneless on the roof. The wrecked shell of a man pranked by Jim and Pam waiting for the CIA to ride in like a knight in shining armor. But in this episode, things are flipped upside down a little bit. There's something about the chaos and the darkness that's hanging over this episode that has really always left me with an uneasy and uncomfortable feeling afterwards. I mean, there is hope. It's sitting there, like right out in the open, waiting to be found. But it's easy to miss amongst the mayhem. It's like getting a voicemail from literal death telling you, you know, hey, keep your chin up.
Death. Death to Toby.
So after two solid minutes of research, I think I've figured out why I have the feeling I do about this episode. It's a Kaling episode. And that's not a bad thing. I think Kaling is a great writer, and I've enjoyed following her career. But when it comes to Office episodes, she revels in the details of darkness. Like, we merely adopted the cringe, but she was born in it. Think of major Kaling episodes that wouldn't have had much showrunner or studio or network involvement. They would be episodes like Hot Girl, Diwali, Ben Franklin, Night Out, Frame Toby, and Secret Santa. And you'll see a theme emerging of using these characters to create the most comedically chaotic circumstances. And while I personally think that every writer seeds a deeper meaning within their work, I'll be honest with you, I've historically had trouble identifying Kaling's thesis ideas. I think for her, the profound is in the pain.
Basically, nobody does anything for me anymore unless I threaten to kill myself.
There's eloquence in the embarrassment. There's understanding in the unbearable. In the end, the greatest snowball isn't a snowball when it's a simple exchange of icy orbs that escalate to the fear of the unknown. And the fear of the unknown is what's driving everyone's behavior in Classy Christmas. Pam fears Jim's reaction. Daryl fears not only Jada's reaction to this party, but also, looking a little deeper, he fears if he's a good father, and he fears if he's going to have the influence he wants on his little girl. Michael fears that his best days are behind him, and that he won't ever find a soup snake like Holly.
Holly, you and I are soup snakes.
He fears that it's too late to have kids, and he fears that nothing in his life is ever going to satisfy. And Jim is just afraid of literal snowballs. Dwight was just being poetic. In the end, the greatest Christmas party isn't a party at all. Classy Christmas is a bleak and desperate look at life, with glimpses of hope sprinkled in to remind us not to lose sight of that which is important and that which props us up for success in the future. Maybe Michael and Holly's arc would be completely different if Michael left the party and never came back as Santa, because we do see this endearing look. At any rate, fear of the unknown is never going away. Merry Christmas, everyone. Let's rate this thing.
This is the worst.
Okay, the cold opening.
Still some people not jumping.
You gotta be kidding me, who isn't jumping?
I've long held the belief that nothing in mundane modern civil society exists on this planet as frustrating as the experience of trying to get more than 7 people to pose for a picture. And the frustration level doesn't increase consistently with more humans, but exponentially. People become these weird social monsters when it's time to get in a group for a picture. And this is frustrating for the photographer, but sometimes the photographer is the problem.
Okay, on three, everyone in the air. 3, 2, 1, 0.
Just, okay, save jump,
they keep tweaking the lineup, the backdrop, something isn't right. like Pam says.
This is just a Christmas card from your paper supplier. No one's putting this on their fridge.
If you ever want to know what it feels like to be a sheep herder, just try to get people to line up and behave for a photo like this. With that established, I think this is a perfectly good cold opening. It keys in on an experience I assume we've all had, and it's great to rewatch this one on repeat and just focus on the different individuals. So I think this one deserves a 3 out of 5. It's good, but not notable.
We didn't get it.
Classy Christmas, though. Okay, everybody, I have some real love for this one, but I also have some beef with this. Let's start with what I didn't like. There seems to be a real pull in the writer's room between the old and new guard. Kayleen, one of the old guard, in an interview with Office Tally way back in 2010, talked about wanting to steer Jim and Dwight away from ever becoming best friends. My take on that is that she just had a distaste for them ever connecting in the first place. In this episode, she wanted Dwight to be really complicated and mean in order to avoid them ever becoming best friends. She said that's the kind of thing that happens in crappy feel-good sitcoms. I think that also explains why Jim's behavior is so bizarre for his character. So if you ever wonder why Jim's behavior is antithetical to the character as we know him, it's just because Kayleen wanted the chaos. And I'm kind of here for it, but in this case, I'm not. It feels as artificial as the snow. And that's one of my criticisms of The Office in general. While assigning lead responsibilities out to different staff members does keep the show fresh, and these people are all immensely talented at their craft, the problem is that they're also different. A Brent Forrester episode is lighthearted and full of cheer, overshadowing the very real darkness that is the underbelly of society.
Here we go. Oh, God!
Oh.
He doesn't ignore that darkness. He chooses to write comedy to inspire people through it. Novak seems to like to find the nuance in things.
You
help you, Michael.
Bitch, it's God!
Eisenberg and Stupnitsky like to have a silly, fun time, and kind of like a, wouldn't it be funny if this were backwards or upside down? Sullivan and Warren Lieberstein seem to like situational comedy. Mike Schur likes to find the redemption stories. And all of these people write incredibly great television. But it wreaks havoc on arcs across the series. It's like, is Michael Scott smart or stupid? It just depends on who's writing for him. Is Dwight lost in fantasy or is he grounded? Just depends on who's writing for him. Is Jim the kind of person who would go out, pack a snowball, and throw it in a coworker's face from 6 feet away? It is when Kayleen's the lead writer. And this isn't a criticism of Kayleen, you know, per se. I guess it kind of is. But really, it's just a part of the bigger picture of how a series like this used to be made for network television. You start with a great premise, you define a few major arcs, and then you iterate on that until the well runs dry. In today's environment, expectations seem to be shifting with series like The Good Place and Schitt's Creek, a couple that I'm familiar with, maybe you can call out more in the comments, whose showrunners and writing staff have all of the arcs for each season already crafted in order to tell one coherent story that they want to tell. Ideas that don't fit into the bigger picture, as good as they may be, are vetoed or repurposed conceptually later. The end product is a streamlined story of evolutionary growth and characters rather than a lot of starts and stops. And I know we all perpetually take 2 steps forward and 1 step back, so I do understand that art is imitating life here a little bit, but it's also difficult to separate how much I've come to appreciate the new writing style versus this old style. But it's not just Jim and Dwight who act uncharacteristically dark and vindictive. This might be the most targeted act of mean-spiritedness that Michael takes in this entire series.
And I can be mature about that.
Most often, he's incidentally a terrible person for very generalized reasons, unless you're Toby.
Why are you the way that you are? I hate so much about the things that you choose to be.
But it seems pretty hardcore for Mike, uncharacteristically so. So is it all bad? Well, a holly Christmas with very few jollies is a shift in the story. To date, season 7's goal has been to demonstrate growth in Michael Scott and to hook us into the deeper characters. And also, I'll double down that Ed Helms was being groomed to take over Carell's place. It is a for sure thing. I don't know why people argue with me about this. Do we want it? No, I don't think anybody ever did. But it was the plan. But Classy Christmas represents a paradigm shift in the season for Michael. The groundwork has already been laid, and now the path is being built for his eventual departure. Michael still has a lot of growth left, but each step brings he and Holly closer to each other and closer to Colorado. So beyond the macro level stuff in this episode, is it a good episode of The Office? Yes, there is more than enough in this one to love. The snowball fight, while out of character, is a great idea for the writers to play with. Michael's desperation and eventual soft-heartedness is very tender. The gift exchange hits me in the feels, and the ending of this one turns the trope of watching Jim having the upper hand upside down. Lastly, we have to appreciate the amount of work that went into creating this. It is a supersized version of The Office, and it involved complicated props, set design, costume work, and we could spend all day talking about how awesome this shot actually is. All of this is even more impressive when you consider that this one was directed by Rainn Wilson himself, something that I'm kicking myself for not actually bringing up until right now in the video. It's a great work for a brand new director. At the end of the day, the episode needed to be two things. It needed to be funny. And it needed to stick Holly's landing in Scranton. All up, I think it executes on those premises. Forgetting those high level complaints I have about this one, I'm gonna give this a 4 out of 5. But that's just what I think about Classy Christmas. What are your thoughts? Leave them in the comments, tell me what I missed, and join me next week when we cover The Ultimatum.
Eat it! Eat it!
Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.